the meeting here. Whenever you're ready.
Okay, thanks folks, start the meeting at 16:02. This is open again, Mr. Chairman. We've done the call to order, I'm sure. Public comment, anything, any comments from the public? Anybody wants to say anything? No? Okay, thank you. Approval of the minutes of last month, that will be May the 13th this year. Mr. Lemon, have you read the minutes? Are you okay with them? And Mr.?
Yeah, I'm okay with the minutes. And I had the following resolution to offer it and their acceptance by the meeting.
Can you make that a motion, Commissioner Lemon? Okay, Mr. Riffle, have you any comment on the minutes?
No, I've read the minutes.
Read the minutes. Commissioner Belmont, are you in favor of making the motion to accept the minutes of last month? And if so, would you mind doing that? Good, okay. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Good, are we all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye, good. No more questions? Motion passed. 3-0. At this time, I would like to change the agenda just a touch here due to the fact that we have a notary public coming in at exactly 4:30, and I'd like to do that. My plan was to do that after the approval of the last month's minutes. As you all know, our chief has been in long conversations with all kinds of agencies regarding this communication problem that we've had. It seems to be at an end now. It seems to have come to 100% fruition. A contract has been drawn up. The chief has had it. And the three commissioners, including myself, have had a copy of that, have access to a copy of that. My question to the other two commissioners is, have you read it? Do you have any questions or any comments? Because there's going to come a time during this meeting that we have to approve that contract. So, Mr. Wilmot, now's your time. Any questions?
Mr. Chairman, I don't believe I've seen the writing you speak of.
Okay. That is the contract that Chief Carlton has put together with the telephone company regarding the communication.
Yes. Okay, I'm aware of that. Yes. I'm good with that.
Okay, my question is, do you have any comments to this, or any questions regarding this contract?
No, I don't.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Riffle, are you?
I received the contract. It was sent by email to me from the fire chief. And the only question I have, and I'm not trying to blindside here, it said in there if we take additional rack space,
correct,
it would be an additional $550 a month.
Correct.
That sort of brought up the red flag.
Yeah, it brought up the red flag for me too. So that's a stipulation that if we have to add another 19-inch rack to the existing, that cost would be the extension of adding that additional rack. We foresee no need to add an additional 19-inch rack at any time in our future with the need of communication that we are going to have on that tower. So that's just a stipulation. If we go into something, we become really, really big, or this becomes a main tower for the county, let's say, and FARS gets involved, some other people get involved, then that cost would have to be extended to them, obviously, if they wanted to put another rack in here, it would be. But in our purposes, the 19-inch rack is going to be plenty for the needs that we have as a district.
And of course, it would just be prudent for me to ask the question, you've really checked into this with the folks that are doing it, I'm sure.
Yes, yeah, so working with Northwest Communications, the 19-inch rack is what we're installing into Whidbey, and what we're also putting into Prospect Dispatch Center down there, and both will meet our needs sufficiently.
And the only other concern I came up with, and I thought it was covered well, was insurance. I wanted to make sure that our insurance has put or been informed that there is that liability up there that they need to cover for us.
Yeah, great question. And the wonderful thing is I just spoke with Tony Kelly prior to the meeting. He does not see any issues with the insurance requirement that's within this contract at this point. He has a copy of the contract. He will vet that with ESIP, but we have a $10 million ceiling level that we have within our insurance with ESIP. So we're well covered there. So.
Okay, and then of course it'll come up in September when we're switching insurance companies, but we'll...
Yeah, if we decide to do that in September, we're already with ESIP, so we're underneath our new insurance since last September. If we have any switch coming up this September, then that'll be vetted during that shift if we choose to go with another provider.
Also, all the concerns I had, the contract is a little long, but it sure covered everything.
Yeah, it's quite extensive, an extensive contract. This contract follows the other agreements that they have in place with Island County Emergency Responding Districts that utilize their towers in the Whidbey area as well. So it really conforms to that. The only difference is a much decreased cost for us because of the size of our district. We don't have multiple districts coming together to pool their funds to pay for such a radio enhancement. And they understood that, and they very nice in reducing the cost substantially for this district. It's going to be $400. The contract will be published online. I'll put that out there for the public to see and to read. But it's going to start out at $400 a month in the first year, and every year there's a 3% added to that. So we have the option to have it for 15 years. There's 2 5-year renewals built into the contract as well. And so to start out, it's going to be $4,800. By the end of the contract, at the end of the 15 years, it will be the cost to this district will be $7,200 with a 3% added each year for 15 years or 14 years, I should say. So that'll be the, right now it's $4,800, but at the end of 15 years, $7,200 with a 3% cost associated each year.
Good. Anything else, Mr. Stan?
No. Who's going to sign the contract?
The chief is going to sign that, and that's why I brought up the fact that we need to know the contract. On page 18 of the contract, that would be the telephone company signed it already. The chief had to make one slight change to it, and so when the chief signed it, in accordance to the rules of the notary public today at 4:30 or thereabouts, then we have a half legal document. He will then make sure that Whidbey Island Telephone or Whidbey Telephone Company gets the contract. They'll sign it in the presence of the notary public, and then it's done.
Okay. Yeah. So the contract that I sent you had their signatures already on it. We, finding that mistake on the last overview of the contract, we found a mistake, and I called them today. They corrected it, but they were unable to get it signed and notarized on their end. So they sent me the revised contract, and it was just a wording change. The fire district that they were dealing with, because again, this matches other districts' contracts. And we had to change a fire district that was in a line of the contract at the very, very end that we all missed in the beginning. To our district, and therefore it left it unsigned on their end. But now we'll sign it, we'll have it notarized, we'll send it back to them, they'll sign it, notarize it, put the effective date in as well, and then they'll send us a final copy, and they'll keep a copy as well.
What action do we have to take?
We should take it, Mink and I. Jeff and Stan, we have to come up with a motion here before this document is signed that authorizes Chief Carlton to sign the document on behalf of Fire District 5. Ask both of you to put your heads together here. I'll do the same thing and come up with a motion regarding this. Once we have the motion in place, I feel very confident we can give the whole thing to the notary public knowing that we have, a motion on file, and we have authorized Chief Carlton to sign for us. Do you have any ideas, Jeff, how you want to word this motion, or shall I ask Stan?
I'm listening intently, but I don't think I'm qualified to write the resolution yet.
Okay. Stan, it's really a simple motion. I can make it too if you want.
Well, I think it's a simple motion, so let's keep it simple. Motion to approve the contract as presented, 18-page contract as presented, and as part of that motion, we authorize our Fire Chief Carlton to sign the contract on our behalf.
You understand that by the chief signing it, and if we give him permission, he's accepting it on our behalf.
That's exactly what I mean by my motion.
Okay. All right, if that's what you want to do, Linda, are you okay with that?
Motion to approve the contract as presented and to authorize Chief Carlton to sign the Whitby, I should put the Whitby telecom contract in the first part of it, and on behalf of WCFD5.
That's perfect. Thank you. Okay.
That's fine. So that's my motion. It's looking for a second.
Jeff, did you hear this?
Thank you.
Good. Are we all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, no more questions? If so, then this motion passed 3-0. Now, let's just continue with the agenda here, and we'll interrupt it when Vicki Robertson comes in to play an audit public here. Patty, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Good, welcome. You want to? It's really nice to hear you.
Yeah, it's nice to hear you, Patty. So.
Can you hear me all right?
Yeah, you're pretty loud, actually.
You're pretty loud, yeah.
Oh, okay.
You tone it down a little?
That'll be the only time I'm loud. On speakerphone, how's that?
Yeah, that's fine. Patty, do you want to do the financial report right now? Are you ready?
Oh, yes, I am ready.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. This is the financial report for Fire District 5 as of June 10th, 2015. Warrants total $21,648.33. Items to mention, over $1,000 would be U.S. Bancorp, the credit card, in the amount of $8,020.41, and Shell, $1,127.22. Volunteer payroll included in warrants total $5,027. Payroll is in the amount of $14,231.67. This includes Chief Carlton's salary at $4,166.67 and Assistant Chief Shields pay at $2,667. There was one event per commissioner and the secretary. The volunteer portion totaled $5,982, and the total payout for volunteers, warrants included, is $11,009. And our May financial statements are in your new meeting book. And I'm looking for motions to approve the warrants for June in the amount of $21,648.33. And in addition to that, payroll in the amount of $14,231.67.
Thank you, Patty.
Thank you.
Jeff, did you get all that?
Yes.
Good.
I got it all.
Beautiful. It's terrible.
But I'd be willing to make a motion. If Jeff has no concerns, I don't have any concerns. I would make a motion to approve the warrants in the amount of $21,648.33. I would make a second motion to approve payroll in the amount of $14,231.67. That's two motions looking for a second.
Thank you, Stan. Jeff, do you want to second those two?
Second the motions.
Good, thank you. Are we all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
No more further questions? Motion passed. 3-0. Thanks, Betty. You want to stay on the line or are you going to do something else?
I'm going to head out unless anyone has a question about anything.
No, anybody, Stan or Jeff, do you have any questions regarding the budget? Now's your chance. Patty is right on the phone. You know, good. How about you?
I don't have any questions. However, the one question I have is I believe the RCWs require, if you're attending a meeting, you have to attend the entire meeting on phone.
Patty doesn't fall under that umbrella.
Okay, just asking.
No, you're absolutely right. Thank you. Patty is on her own pay scale, right, Patty?
Yes, I'm not a, I guess, per meeting. Yes.
Oh, you're free to go. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Patty. Appreciate it.
Okay, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Be in touch.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Chief Correspondent.
Yeah. So, Commissioner Wilmot, are you still there?
I am.
Okay, great. So, we had a couple correspondents last month, and they dealt with some medical calls that we've ran, one in May, and the other letter that we received was from a medical call that we ran back in September of 2014, and to give us an update on how those patients are doing. So these are just cards that you're welcome to read as well. Other correspondence, I do not have other correspondence within the month.
Thank you, Chief. Why don't we continue with the Chief's report?
So the Chief's report for May, for June of 2015, resulting for May of 2015. Point of information, I have 4 points to go over, and the first one I want to go over is our ISO rating with the Washington State's Rating Bureau. We were fortunate enough to have done the necessary work over the last few years of compiling our training records, improving the type of service our apparatus get, those records, maintaining those, our hose records, ladder records, our personnel. We've increased about 15 people on our ranks since I took over in 2012. Which also increased the amount of certified firefighters we have within the district. So the Washington State Rating Bureau looks at all these types of things, including our water distribution system, the amount of hydrants we have, the amount of gallons we have in within our system at any given point, the daily usage they look at as well, the highs and lows, which is something we don't control. That's the water district's responsibility. The age of that system, the age of our hydrants, whether or not we have Stortz couplings on our hydrants, which are quick fitting connections that would help us with the efficiency on our side. And beyond that, it comes back to the district and its amount of personnel that are available during the day, that are available at night, that respond during the day, that respond at night. The fire training, again, the ISO rating, WSRB, the Washington State Rating Bureau, they only look at the fire service side of what we do. Medically, having paramedics, having ambulances, anything like that, advanced equipment, does not correspond into their rating scales. So that has nothing to do with it. It's all about our fire trucks, the personnel that we have, the products we put out there for the public on the fire side. And we've worked really hard. And all of our records came open to Washington State Rating Bureaus. We had three-inch binders of copies of the information that they requested. We handed those over, and my hopes was that we would at least stay at a 6 and not drop into a worse category that would increase insurance ratings. We got a letter from them, and we reduced to a 5. So it was a nice ending to all the hard work that we've done. Having a conversation with them shortly, and I plan on calling them this week to really go through their rating structure and all the different areas of that to see where we can improve upon over the next 4.5 years. Their plan is to come back in 2020. I do believe there are areas that we can become very, very strong in and acquire multiple points that we were unable to do this time. And one area of that would be fire safety inspections in the commercial businesses that we have here on point, doing those on a yearly basis, and also fire home inspections, having people allow us to come into their homes, make sure that they have, you know, the required smoke detectors that are needed, and doing a walkthrough and identifying anything that would make it difficult for us to access the home or for them to exit the home in case of a fire. So there's a massive amount of points that can be gained just by doing that one thing. We have the fire marshal, Whatcom County Fire Marshal comes up here, and they are the ones that have been doing all the life safety inspections, and they have the legal authority to fine and to put monetary pressure, again, penalties against commercial businesses that are not falling underneath the current regulations in place when it comes to fire safety systems like sprinkler systems, smoke detectors, of course, and then the fire extinguishers. We do not have that regulatory authority, so we do correction notices only. Now, these business walkthroughs and these home walkthroughs would just be for the benefit of the business owner and the homeowner. It would be in no way of a corresponding negative for them to the fire marshal's office or anything like that. So it would just help them come up to standard or to make their place of business safer or their home safer for their family. So that's one area. Another area is that we have not been weighing our vehicles. We never knew we needed to weigh our vehicles because they're exempt vehicles. But we missed points by not weighing our vehicles. They need to have a specific road test done as well, and we did not know that. So that's something else that we can improve upon, and then there's other things as well. The biggest thing is response and how many firefighters we get on scene of fire calls. And they look at day and night time, as I said. Right now, we're down to 39 members from 45. We've had a number of members be picked up by other professional organizations on the Canadian side. I currently have four, I believe I've received phone calls on for references. So they're in the final processes within those hirings, and Gary is one of those. So he might be getting picked up sometime in the near future as well, and that means we're going to lose our chef because he's the cook. But anyway, so I just wanted to let the public know that they need to call their insurance company. And since we did have a reduction, I got an email from one of our residents here, and it was a woohoo email that I forwarded to the commissioners. And her homeowner's insurance decreased by $85 a year. So for some people, that's a lot of money. For other people, it's a weekend out. So but for some, it's a lot of money. So I think any reduction that we can help by doing our job to the best of our ability on this district's end is a benefit to the community. So that's the first thing I wanted to report. The second thing is vandalism to the station and to Assistant Chief's home. We had somebody egg the fire station. They egged the front of the clinic, the side of the clinic, and the back of the fire station. And they also egged the front of Assistant Chief Shields' personal residence over there. We did open up a law enforcement report on that. We contacted the sheriff. They have an open investigation going on, and most likely we won't, know whoever did that type of vandalism. It seems, we're getting more and more done on property. We had somebody there over at the skate park, and they put up a hammock in between our two signs over there in the parking area. And she's bending over the signs, in her hammock with no concern that it's not her property or anything else. And we had to come out and let her know that it was fire department property and that she needed to remove herself from the hammock and take the hammock down in between the two signs. So there's concern. At a later date, obviously, as Commissioner Wilmot recommended, and I agree with that, we still need to look at the security of the station at a later date after we get all of this radio communications done and have a good conversation about that to see what we would like to do in order to beef up identifying these types of incidents, especially if it hits the clinic, it breaks windows at the clinic, you know, damages that for the public, that's the concern. So I don't want to talk about it today, but I know it's something that we need to bring up at some point in the future at a later meeting. So communication agreements are in place, so I was successful at having a Customs Border Patrol sign an agreement with us to allow us to come in free of charge to their command center down in Blaine. And then Washington State Patrol has given us the same courtesy due to the agreement back in 2010, I believe, that was between the county and the law enforcement agencies during the Olympics in Canada, because the Olympic command center was actually here in Whatcom County at that point. So we had an EOC, Emergency Operations Center, set up here. So that put in place the fiber optic that we needed to tag onto with Washington State Patrol. And that agreement within all those agencies at that time extended no cost to those agencies for future use. Therefore, Washington State Patrol has given us that courtesy to tag in on their fiber optic from their headquarters down at Bellingham Airport into Prospect Dispatch. So that's we're ready to go. So right now we've been purchasing, the district hasn't, but Northwest Communications has been purchasing equipment since we approved the emergency funding of the $70,000, or before that a little bit less, but approved the emergency funding. And so we're waiting on our microwave license to come back, and then we're going to start putting equipment up. And they projected completion date from Northwest Communications is the end of July, because we could see a couple weeks of necessity of getting that microwave license back from, I think, the FCC at this point. So end of July, I hope to be up and running with the new communication systems, therefore giving our members and the community the trust and the effectiveness that they both need when it comes to an emergency call out. The last thing on my point of information is we completed a new hire academy with 12 prospects. So again, we're down right now 6 individuals. I'll probably bring on a couple extra. I might bring our ranks closer to the 50 mark. But we have 12 prospects. I don't think we've ever had this strong of a class. The last 2 weekends, Saturdays and Sundays, they've done full 8-hour days of firefighter skill sets. They're all fully trained firefighters. They're certified Fire 1, Fire 2 through IFSAC, which is the International Fire Service Accreditation Congress or Council. And they've gone through their training. Now they're getting picked up with us, and we're just bringing them up to our standards and our expectations when it comes to pulling hose loads, hydrants, access, those types of things, and truck operations. But we have a really strong group. I think it's going to be difficult for me to make a decision, but I'll be interviewing these 12 individuals over the next few weeks and then making a choice on how many and who to bring forwards into the organization to support this community emergency response. And hopefully they'll be on board by July 1st.
You might want to add, so you've got one female aspiring.
Yeah, the female that we have in this class, we'll have a female in the next class or before as well, but she's an amazing individual, and it's going to be extremely positive note for the fire service in general. Physically able to do the job, but her persona is what really leads the way for her. So she, she's in my top 3 actually in the ranking at this time, and hopefully in the interview process with me, she'll remain in that placement. But I'm afraid that she's going to get picked up very, very quickly on the Canadian side. So I don't think we'll have her for very long if she is brought into the organization, but that's a positive for her as well. So we have another female who physically, she wasn't able to get through the physical agility in the time frame, but she completed it. We spent time with her, she never quit, and she completed the physical agility. And the wonderful thing about this young lady is she understands what she needs to do, and that's, she's admitted she needs to get into the gym a little bit and to become a little bit stronger so she's quicker. Because it's just going to help her pass the physical agilities that are mandated with Vancouver Fire, Burnaby, any other fire organization in the Lower Mainland that she's going to have to test with. She'll have to pass the physical agility. So we'll get her through it. The amazing thing is she scored the highest out of the entrance exam. So in our hiring process, we give a Fire 1, Fire 2 entrance exam. We give it written. They have to pass that written in order to make it to the next step. So our process, we vet as closely as we possibly can to any career organization and any requirements that they have. They have to go through interviews, they have to go through a physical agility, and then they have to go through a chief's interview. So it's the same process as, let's say, Delta would put somebody through as well. But we had over 50 people take the written, and we only took 20 or so to the process. So you can see firefighters that, you know, certified firefighters, but they haven't gotten back in the books, and that's what hurts, right? Because you have to kind of get back in the book knowledge to pass the written exam. So I'm looking forward to the future. I think if we continue getting kind of professionals that we currently have like this coming into the organization, I think it's going to be great. Okay.
Thank you, Chief. At this time, Vicki, nice to see you. Do you mind coming over here? Please, do you have the document?
Yeah. Somewhere. Hi.
Hi.
So, hey. Commissioner Wilmot, we're going to sign the contract with Whitby right now.
Okay.
We're going to be signing the contract with Whitby right now.
Captain Hollywood?
No? Chef.
Yeah.
Just chef.
Okay, then.
Sorry, everybody, for the pause. Thanks for being patient.
That's almost the same idea as when you get married.
Did you really bring that up? The relationship's going good. Just let everybody know.
Did the teddy bear on Valentine's Day work?
The teddy bear.
Did you get something else?
No, the teddy bear. I got the teddy bear.
Teddy bear worked?
Yeah, the teddy bear. It's fine.
How was your pedicure and your manicure?
Oh, God. My hands look good. My feet look good.
Hey, look, you can sit on a hammock out here. And...
yeah.
Do you have to look every quarter now?
No, I no. That was
you can talk about it.
Something we did together.
Are we on camera?
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Oh, good. Yeah, it's being videotaped. So it's great.
A little while. Yeah.
What color did you go on your toes?
Nope. No, there's no color. No color on the toes.
I call you Chief Tippy Toe.
I want to say that's a Washington Fire District.
That's what I was wondering.
Some of this fire district. I appreciate that, Commissioner, though, bringing that up.
Thank you, Tom.
Bringing that up.
Okay. Let me know when
we'll have a little look that over and make sure that we have it right there.
Commissioner Wilmot, the contract has been notarized for Whitby Telecom, so can I continue with my fire chief's report? Okay, apparatus, there's nothing in the report except for age 58 and age 5802. We had a diesel leak in age 58, it was dripping on the floor, so we took it down to the repair shop that deals with all BC ambulances in Richmond. And it was the fuel filter bracket that goes bad on these Ford, I think it's the 450 there, but they were able to replace it and we're back in business. It only took a day. 85802, we had the heater repaired in the back of it. We found out during one of the cooler days in the early part of this year, we had a patient, we were utilizing 85802, and it was blowing out cold air. So we used like, I don't know, 6 or 7 blankets on the patient in order to keep them warm. But we got that fixed for this coming up winter, so that's a positive. Member roster has dropped from 45 to 39. We have 28 Canadians, 6 Point Roberts and 5 County. We have 4 paramedics on staff, 15 EMTs, which of 4 are advanced EMTs. We're going to be adding a 5th advanced EMT because Christina Tersakian, actually 2 more advanced EMTs. Christina Tersakian has passed her National Registry psychomotor skill sets. Now she's going to be taking her written. So hopefully by August she'll be on board and functioning at the advanced EMT level. Josh Martin from District 7, who volunteers here as well, has passed his National Registry psychomotor skill sets and will be taking the written and therefore hopefully be functioning in that role in August too. We have 3 ambassadors on board, which we have 1 here today. And we have 34 firefighters within that staffing. Volunteer hours for the month of May, 2,749 hours. Volunteer payroll, $11,273, if everyone was getting paid. Combined chief hours, I worked 152.5. Assistant Chief Shields worked 144.5, for a total of chief hours for this district of 297. We had 19 calls, so we actually had a busy month in May. 19 calls, we had 11 EMS calls. 2 of those we transported down to St. Joseph's Hospital. We had 7 no transports. We had 1 transport to North Whatcom Fire Rescue and 1 to Ferndale Medic 45. I made 3 contacts for home visits last month as well to patients that we had actually been called out for a 911 call and just following up with those patients if they need anything else from this district. Public service, we had 1. Fire classifications, we had 6 calls, 1 permitted burn, 3 smoke investigations, 1 odor investigation, and we had 1 beach fire. Now I'm going to add something to the beach fire. And we had 1 wrong address, we got dispatched incorrectly. Beach fires, this is something that has changed, and it just came out from the Whatcom County Fire Marshal's Office. The Whatcom County Fire Marshal's Office has stated a possible misunderstanding from prior, but I need to make the public aware that starting this year, really last month, they are able to burn driftwood. So driftwood can now be burned in fire pits, which it's always been viewed as illegal from the fire marshal's office. So it's always been a no-go if we see people burning the driftwood. But now, people can actually burn the driftwood in their outdoor recreational fire pits if they want to. So there's a lot of concern down on Maple Beach, a lot of concern around Lighthouse Park because the logs pile up and they're afraid that come November, December, when the tides are heavy and they come in, that those logs are going to be brought over into their yards or into their homes. So now the benefit is, I need to get that out in my next chief's chat, but the public can burn that type of wood now. So does anybody have any questions on that?
I take it that's approval of a burn pit only at that individual home?
That's correct. They still have to be in a burn pit. We had, the beach fire we had was from a flare from the Coast Guard, I think auxiliary, or the boaters group. They were launching off their old flares for practice. And one flare drifted and landed in the beechwood. And actually, it was pretty impressive when we showed up. So it was about 20, 30 feet in the air with the flames. And a large portion, probably a 20 by 30 area of logs were on fire. And we were out there for at least a couple hours suppressing the fire. But it was a real event for us. So it was exciting. It was actual fire. So you can't set the beach on fire, is what I'm saying. That's not allowed. Someone can't just go out there and douse the whole log pile of gasoline and set it on fire, right, because they want to. It still has to be an approved pit, okay, and you still have to have the permit and everything like that. Yes?
So are you saying we can go down and get driftwood and bring it to our home?
As far as I understand, yeah, as far as I understand, that driftwood can be burned. Now, can you take it off the beach and just burn it at your home? I mean, I see it, there are a lot of homes use it for decorative pieces, and which is, you know, I don't have an issue, you know, with that. I don't necessarily have an issue with that. I don't know if somebody saw you doing that and they called me, and I contacted the fire marshal's office and say, listen, they're taking it from the beach into their own pits. Is this allowed? I think that's something that I would vet at that time. So, but I know people want to get rid of it, you know. Their personally owned land, you know, the people that own the beach rights in front of their homes, obviously they can do it. Now, if they decide to give some of that to friends, I don't know where the ruling would be on that, right? But if someone notifies me that someone's transporting wood off the beach, then obviously I have to look into that. And then I would have to probably call the fire marshal's office and see if they would allow that to transpire. So, yeah.
You're on beach patrol now?
Yeah, I plan on being on beach patrol, so really probably have fun. Yes?
Doesn't the parks people ding you if you take it off the beach? They used to.
Yeah.
What? There's a sign at Lighthouse Park saying you can't take it.
Yeah, and so that's going to be interesting, and I'll have to contact the fire marshal's office on that to see if it doesn't include parks, right? The parks are off limits. That it may just be to privately owned beach or land that the driftwood is on at that point.
Yeah, that'd be a valid phone call to find that out and talk to Ben over here.
Yeah, but those who do have that private land or beach front that they own, they're able to burn it now, which in the past we've always been instructed that that has been illegal because of the toxins within the wood. So, yes?
Yeah, just going back here to your ISO approval that you've gotten, that's excellent, wonderful. Yes. I did some Googling of ISO versus fire insurance, and it's very interesting. I couldn't come up with anything for Washington State, but I came up for the state of Connecticut and Kentucky and some other place. And the average reduction in fire insurance costs that I noted from the tabulation in the other states seemed to be anywhere from about $10 to about $12 a month for an ISO rating of 6 to 5. Mm-hmm. And they have charts. Some of the states have got absolute charts of what the numbers are.
Right.
Now, I haven't called my insurance yet to ask them what are they going to do for me as a result.
Sure.
But at some point, I'm going to do it because I'm just curious.
Well, one resident has already had $85.
Yes, so, that's what you were saying. Which now, is... I was hoping for about 120. That's greedy.
You want a nice weekend out, is what you want.
That's right.
So, yeah. I don't have any control on what it would be reduced. You know, my hopes is by going through the process of improving where we can and doing the best we can in the areas that we need to improve on, that we have a good shot at taking this district to a number 4 come in 2020. Now, I will tell you what's going to hurt us, and we'll be discussing this in the years to come before 2020, is both of our vehicles will be over 25 years old at that point, and that becomes a big negative for this organization, having engines over 25 years old. So hopefully by 2020, we'll be able to have a new engine in our fleet and have one in reserve, because we have no reserve apparatus either. And that is a negative in point value for us as well. So if we can obtain a new engine by 2020, put one in reserve, that's going to be pluses for us. Even though our two older ones would be 25 years or more, our newest engine would be only a few years old at that point. So that's something that we'll have to look at in planning for the upcoming years with the commissioners, and hopefully be able to obtain a new engine in that. So, any other questions?
Well, on a side note, I called my insurance company too this afternoon and looked it up. It said, I cannot improve on your ratings. What do you mean? Well, you're classified as a 1, which is the absolute best. I don't know where she got that from, but I didn't want to talk about it any further. You may find the same thing that you guys call it.
Yeah.
Yeah, so 10 is the worst, right?
Yeah.
One is the best. And you normally don't see ones unless you're in like New York City, Phoenix, Boston, where they have massive amounts of career firefighters and they have a water system that can supply them massive amounts of water. So.
I understand if you tell them that you're a commissioner, you get a really
good rating. Yeah. I was going to say, what a rule. Just saying, oh, you're number 1.
Yeah.
You're number 1.
Okay, thanks. Chief, we are at the report here.
You have a question?
Yeah, the question is one that you're reducing homeowners insurance?
The fire insurance.
Yeah. Okay. So a couple of years ago, we got insurance on the farm and stuff. First time around, they didn't give us credit for living in a gated community. So we gave them.
Could you speak up a little bit?
I gave him a call back and explained to him that we were a gated community. Mm-hmm. And 7 days later, they called back and gave us credit for that.
Okay.
So we weren't trying to get to the yard.
So if you live in a gated community, it could benefit you.
Yeah.
Well, we do.
If we have access.
Yeah.
So are you talking about the border gated community?
Yes, yes.
So just being a gated community because of the border?
Right.
Yeah, I will definitely put that in my fireside chat and let people vet that and let them know one of our people has a 1. So
don't tell what agency I don't want to leave that alone.
Yeah, but I hope it positively affects those who decide to call and see if they can get an adjustment. So.
All right. Thanks, Beth. Anybody else want to talk about anything? Something?
I'd appreciate if the chief would reiterate the benefits for the community of what the impact of this tower achievement. It's amazing what you've done.
Okay. Right now, we have probably a 3-to-1 obligation for us to. We have to talk to dispatch 3 times for them to hear us once. And that does not necessitate an efficient incident scene for our people. Nor do all of our pager responding volunteers get their pagers activated by the tones that are sent out from the current location, which I believe is on Sumas Mountain or Galbraith. And that's 37 miles away.
Galbraith.
So, Galbraith, I think. So, one of our main responders here on the point, Christina Tersakian, she lives over off McKenzie, a beautiful home that Shant built for them over off McKenzie, that by the big 2 million gallon water tank that we have. But she lives in a wooded area over there, and her pager, she does not receive tones effectively there. So she may miss calls because her pager does not alert her or does not activate. So from this expenditure of public funds through our capital reserves, we will almost be guaranteed, you know, in the 90th plus percentile, that our responders will be activated on the first activation try, and that our radio communications will be received on the first attempt versus on the third attempt. This is a benefit because if our firefighters have to call a mayday when they're inside of a home and they're involved in a collapse, that mayday is heard on the very first attempt, because that may be the only attempt they have. Also, that if we get into a hostile situation on scene and it becomes dangerous for us, that we're able to request law enforcement on the first attempt, because that may be the only attempt we have, depending on the circumstances that we're in. And if we're being held at gunpoint or knife point or have been taken captive, I can say that has happened multiple times around the United States, where a whole entire firefighting crew walks into a home and then they're at gunpoint and now they're captives and bargaining tools for the person that called them. So I'm hoping that 90% plus of the time, we're going to be dispatched off of this tower, and we're going to be communicating off this tower at 199 feet, basically. So it gets us above the tree level, and it'll be somewhere in the 30-watt range that we'll be broadcasting off of and being toned off of. In the trial, the sheets that I put up at a previous meeting showing the blacked out areas or the difficult areas we have on Point Roberts with our paging, all of that should become green for us once this is online. And I will definitely report to you. We will have our downtimes, of course, during maintenance periods and possible electrical outages. Now, if we get a massive earthquake here, hopefully the tower will still be standing. Because if the tower goes down, then we're back to what we've been dealing with. If those towers are still standing after an earthquake event as well. If nothing is up, then we're radio to radio, and then ham radio will become an importance to us at that point to help us in our emergency response. So that's kind of a coverage of that. So yeah, this has been going on for the better part of a year, if not more, trying to get the agreements in place and our partnerships so we can have this type of system in place for this community.
Thank you for doing that.
That's true. Yeah, you're welcome.
Okay. Jeff, are you still there? I haven't heard from you.
Still there.
Good.
Sure am.
Well, we're coming to the end of the meeting. With you guys' approval, I'll ask for adjournment of the meeting. If I have a motion to that effect, and I'll second it.
I'll make a motion to adjourn the meeting.
Thank you, Stan. How about you, Jeff?
It was so moving.
Thank you very much. It's all approved. All in favor, and
aye.
We're done here. Thank you so much.
Commissioner, thank you for being on the phone with us today. So thank you for being here with us today, Commissioner. Thank you. Okay. Thanks, everybody. So technology is fun.